Hi, this is Soni who's running her mouth series, and I'm Soni, and I like to run my mouth. For those of you that don't know me, I'm a transpersonal counselor, a clinical hypnotherapist, an empath, a psychic, EFT master, a whole bunch of things. If you'd like to learn more about me and the services that I perform, you can go to my website at soniweiss.com. The conversation today we're going to have is about the narcissist, the teacher. Generally speaking, I think the term narcissist is a much overused word. You'll find true narcissists are few and far between. And secondly, if you're an emotionally healthy person, you're not going to be attracted to them and they're not going to be attracted to you. I think egocentric or ego-centered is a much better term to use. And I'm going to try and remember to call this, you know, person an egocentric. These are individuals who sort of stopped growing emotionally when it comes to other people's feelings and needs. When we need to keep this in mind, that they haven't emotionally developed all the way for various reasons, usually some sort of trauma, be it a big T or a little T. They got stuck. Maybe at 6 years old or 8 years old, or something happened and they didn't get past that. Ironically, they're often very sensitive individuals who couldn't get hurt easily, and they've been wounded at some age. This doesn't mean that they're selfish behavior is acceptable. What it does mean is we need to keep this in mind, that they're emotionally not totally developed, because we're going to be judging them and shaming them. And they don't need this anymore. They don't. They got plenty of shame. That's what the problem is. And it's unproductive for us, for several reasons. One is, if we shame them and we guilt them, they're just going to bring their wall up even higher because they are behind a wall. And they're going to try and protect themselves. They can't handle any more shame and guilt. And that is what they are doing. They're protecting themselves. It's not just rejecting us. Well, it is on one level, I guess. But we don't want to keep that in the front of our minds. It's not going to help us. They don't feel worthy. For whatever reason, they were abandoned or betrayed, and they got kind of stuck at that place. And they don't feel worthy. And they have actually, underneath the facade, they have low self-esteem. So the judging isn't going to help that. It's not going to change anything. Now, I'm not saying any form or fashion that you should put up with an abusive relationship. No. What I'm saying instead is, blaming someone for not making us happy and condemning them is not going to get anybody anything. Definitely not what we want, which is the love that we got in the relationship to deal with these people. We need to look at the situation from more than one perspective. See why we're attracted to these people to begin with. There's always a purpose, there's always a reason, a lesson to learn from every relationship that we had. And the important ones like this, they're often karmic and soul contracts. So you made the soul contract before you came in, so you might as well use it to your advantage. Egocentric people are often attracted to empaths and healers. Especially individuals that came into this lifetime for a life of service. Egocentric people are like neon signs, you know, vibrationally saying, here, help me, I need some help. And then, of course, we as empaths and healers, we jump right in there because that's what we can do. We feel their pain. The empaths feel their pain. And we're wounded healers ourselves, and we want to fix them. I mean, that's what came into being, healers. We don't want them to hurt anymore because we can feel the pain. Some of us can really feel the pain. And when we're doing our healing, we feel better about ourselves because often we have low self-esteem too. It feeds our egos. A lot of ego here. And codependency is working in here. I know all about that. I have years of experience as being a codependent. I now think of myself as a recovering codependent. We all come in this dimension to experience physically, emotionally, and spiritually just about everything imaginable over a course of many lifetimes. Because we come in to raise our level of consciousness, and that's how we do it. We hear, because on the other side there is no feelings, it's more of a Dr. Spock, Mr. Spock, mind meld type of thing that we do on the other side. We're here so that we can know. Knowing is in your body. And in order to know something, you have to experience. To know of something is in your head. And that's like reading a book. You can read all the books you want about mountain climbing. And you can have a lot of information about it. But until you put your foot on the mountain and your hand in the crack and start climbing, there's you're not going to know. It's totally different. Think about it. And we came in, as I said, to raise our level of consciousness so we can be and not just feel unconditional love. That's what everybody's purpose. Is to eventually be unconditional love. That's what the Christ was, and that's what the Buddha is. All the great avatars, they became and they were unconditional love. And that's what we're coming into. Everybody's purpose is pretty much the same. It is to be eventually unconditional love. What roads we take to get there and how long it takes us is dependent on our choices, as we have free will. Our creator gave us free will. So we have to not only make the right choices, we have to do it for the right reason. The intention is tremendously important. If we can understand this, then life gets a lot simpler. If you see that all your relationships are there for you to learn about yourself, and that you chose these situations and you chose these individuals to help you learn these lessons, you'll find that life is much simpler and it's not as painful. We made soul contracts with these individuals to help us do that, so you might as well work with them. I know that's hard. I'm not saying it's easy. God knows I know. It's not easy. Life is painful. But it doesn't have to be suffering. Pain is simply our body's way of telling us that something needs our attention. Suffering comes from when we're trying to change something that is not changeable. Karma is Newton's third law of physics in action. Actions get reactions. That's Charlie barking. Charlie's the stage manager, the Doberman. The Great Dane, if he walks in, that's Fred, and he's the producer. We all reap what we sow. That's karma. And we want to keep in mind that right now, that every choice we make is going to create karma in the future for us because it's action and reaction. So think about that when you make those choices, especially those ones that are a little on the selfish side. We're here to learn unconditional love, gang. And so we've got to put this into action with the people who we're dealing with. We have to practice it. Like you do any other skill. It's not downloadable. It's something that you make a choice to do. And when you make choices long enough for the same way, and reasons, that they become you. That's the knowing. It's like an Olympic champion. They practice the skills so much that it just flows. It just flows. And that's the same thing that we need to do. We got to practice the skills. And to practice the skills, we need to practice them with somebody. So the role of the egocentric in our life is here to give us the opportunity to make the correct choices for the right reasons. And that's to learn to love ourselves unconditionally and then our fellow man. You can't love someone or something if you don't know who you are, if you don't know what your values are, what you have to give, what your limitations are, our weaknesses, our strengths, our shadow side. We got to know all of that so we know who we are. And this is the road less traveled. And when you do that, then we look for the lessons that we can learn from these people and these highly intensive relationships, and which are often one-sided with emotionally unavailable people, because that gives us an opportunity to put into practice unconditional love. We might want to ask ourselves, though, why we attract these kind of people. And often we've had more than one in our life or two in our lives. Some people we just always keep attracting, live our whole lives with unemotionally available people. We do have to ask ourselves, though, like attracts like, and could there be a component of unavailability in us? I mean, we think of ourselves as being emotionally available. Hell, we're out here giving this all this stuff to this guy or this girl. But are we really totally emotionally available? Think about it. It's a hard question. Didn't like it when I asked myself that. Insights. We as the giver, you've got the egotist who's usually the taker, but they give and take, actually. And then we have the giver, and they think of themselves as giving all the time, but often they can't receive. And sometimes we don't have much choice of staying in a relationship with an egotist or emotionally unavailable people. They're family members, they're our caretakers, they're our parents. And actually, often, because we weren't successful in that relationship, we marry them. I married one. Did you? It's easier when it's your brother or your sister, because you can, flip them off. But when it's a mate or a lover, a strong relationship with a friend, that's hard. That's a lot easier. Because there's so much love involved with that. Family members, they're just sticking with them. But it's not the same thing as having a one for a mate or a lover. With these individuals, we get the opportunity to work out the issues that we didn't with the family members, like a mother or a father. If we're aware of what we're doing, we can often clear up and do a lot of letting go if we're aware of what we're doing. And the reason that we can do this in these relationships is because of this intense love that we often have. Even if it's a toxic relationship, we think that we love these individuals. It can be self-destructive, certainly, but it's this hope of getting this love that's going to keep us in the game and let the egotist become a mirror for us. Well, that's what their role actually is. They are the mirror. We're both mirrors for each other, but the egoist in our life, because it's we're talking about us, not them, their role is to be a mirror for us. And we can learn a lot. We can really grow if we want to. Giving seems to be a lot safer when you think about it, especially if you're not giving to yourself. If we're fixing someone, an emotionally unavailable person, we may be giving materially and we may be trying to fix them. But are we really giving what they need? Are we giving them what we project onto them? That is often the case. Receiving, even if we're the giver or we're the egoist, can be very scary. What if you really like what you're receiving? It gives you a lot of pleasure and validation, and then someone can take it away. There is some potential for some serious pain here on both sides of the relationship. Certainly the egoist needs the validation. They need the validation. They don't know who they are. Well, they need, most of the time, the person who's giving. So they need that validation. And if they really get in there and allow you to love them totally, you could take it away. And if you take it away, they think that they're going to lose themselves. They don't know who they are to begin with. So they're going to lose themselves, and that's going to hurt like hell. So they keep you at arm's length. And so does the giver. They're keeping you at arm's length, too, because they're not giving them themselves. They're fixing you. They're not unconditionally loving you. They're fixing you. So everybody is at arm's length, and the equivalent of arm's length really is you're putting a wall up. So what you do is you keep them at arm's length with these walls, and so you can control the amount of pain that you're getting. You know what to expect if you're dealing with an emotionally unavailable person. You've dealt with them before. So you know what you can expect from them, so you can control the amount of pain. So, and we don't even think of ourselves as being control freaks. We are. The egoist, and I guess we both of us in this situation, deep down inside, doesn't think they are anything. So important to understand this. So many clients I've had, this is the same thing. They don't realize that they have anything to give. They really, genuinely don't believe they have any value. So if they don't give to anybody, what difference does it make? They aren't anything. They aren't. And they don't get it. They don't get it how they can hurt people by not giving of themselves, because they don't think there's anything to them to begin with. I know that sounds crazy, but I've talked to so many people about that, and I've done it myself. And they need to be validated. They need your validation. And of course, the giver is getting validation because they're healing you and fixing you. So that makes them important and gives them value. So it's a reciprocal thing. Both of us in a relationship are afraid of losing themselves, arm's length. So we're also afraid to receive, really receive. It's just too painful. And to really, to love somebody, and you took it away. I mean, it's terribly destructive. Real love, which most of us don't do until we get our acts together, is between two whole people. It's not two half people wanting to come together and making one. And to be whole, you have to love yourself unconditionally. And we've got to love ourselves. Love ourselves first. And when we love ourselves first and we know who we are, and then we can deal with pain. We can put ourselves out there. We can be vulnerable. And you can't have a loving relationship without being vulnerable. You can get hurt. Sometimes you're not gonna get hurt. I tell you, loving ourselves and unconditionally loving, it's damn hard. It's damn hard. I haven't mastered it. Sometimes I can do it, sometimes it's not. I'm better at it than I used to be. I can do it for longer periods of time, thanks to some of the narcissists in my life. But it's hard. What we define as love in this third dimension that we live in is more like bartering. It's not unconditional. Unconditional means I'm just going to love you no matter who you are, what you are. Doesn't mean I'm going to approve of your behavior necessarily. But no matter what, I'm going to love you, warts and all. And sometimes maybe especially warts. But the bartering that most of us do, because we don't like to be alone, most people, the biggest thing they fear, studies out on that now, is being alone. But what we do is we say, if you'll do this for me, I'll do the same for you. You give me your warm energy, your body, a little lust, that's okay. And I'll give the same back to you. And fulfill my image of, my warrior or a princess. And I'll raise your children. And I'll clean the house. And you can go out and earn a living and pay the bills and go to war. So it's a contract. It's a reciprocal contract. And hopefully, after the initial lust and the infatuation goes, we can learn to love each other. But that takes time. We live in this Judeo-Christian culture. And it's built on guilt and shame. And we bring in from past lives burdens of guilt and shame. It comes from day one. We're born into it. Sometimes even your mother tells you, I almost died for you. A Jewish mother. I've got an Irish Catholic mother. And they know how to bring out that shame in everybody. Egocentrists are like somewhat like children. Young children are egocentric. They think the world revolves around them. And it's easy for them to receive. And they don't give. They don't always share their toys or anything like that. They want everything that they give comes to them. And that's often, the egocentric person is like that. And I say they got stuck back there. Advance very much. And then on top of that, we're taught from childhood, to give. That it's better to give than receive. I don't know if it is or not. I have to think about that. I haven't made that decision. In fact, it's a question I've been asking clients. If you could only do one, give love or receive love, which would you choose? I mean, really think about it. It's a hard question. So that gives us problems about receiving. And then with men, women particularly are taught this as children, because we're supposed to be the caretakers. And then the boys are told that big boys don't cry. Men show their love by providing materially for the family, by protecting them physically from lions, tigers, and all of this stuff. They go to war. They go to war globally, corporate-wise. And in order to do this, they have to compartmentalize. Men and women don't think the same way, obviously. Women can connect things, they keep it together. Men compartmentalize, they're much better at it. If they didn't, would they go to war? or they go out there and get themselves killed, maimed. Although I have to say, now with women's liberation, we have put ourselves out into that same field. But up to this point, to recent, 50, 60 years, men died a lot younger than women did. Part of it's, the accidents, the things that men put themselves into, they're always, they put themselves in the more dangerous jobs because women were pregnant. You have to have children to keep the human race going. That's complicated. It's not as simplistic as we would like to think. Men were forced to do these things too. Pendulum, I think, definitely swung too far. But that's another lecture. So much of what we give is not real giving. It's from a place of self-sacrifice and martyrdom. Actually, women. I just like to say men are selfish. The giver in the relationship often, though, gets a secondary gain, which they don't even realize what they're doing when they're in martyrdom and self-sacrifice. We get the feeling of being superior. Okay, I'm good to you. I'm not taking anything back. See, that's what my mom told me to do. That's what my religion, that's what my culture tells me to do. It is better to give than receive. And certainly, I need to share everything with you. If there's only one piece, I need to give it to you. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. Not at all. We all need to learn to do that. But we also need to know why we're doing it and what we're doing. That's a choice. Right? And when we do give this self-sacrifice, we can really feel good about ourselves. We're superior to everybody else. You all know somebody who does that. I'm not criticizing. Don't get me wrong. I don't have all these answers. Life is complicated. God, it's complicated. And it's hard. And I haven't mastered it either. Just learning stuff and sharing it with you. We all came in with a lot of baggage. We came in with baggage from past lives, and then we accumulate it for this entire lifetime. And we forget that. We forget that when we're judging other people. And that's some of the baggage that we have to let go of in order to be unconditional love. We didn't realize everybody's got baggage, everybody's got problems. Everybody's had some degree of trauma, even if they don't let us know it. You got enough shame and guilt, hell, you're not going to let anybody else know that your life isn't perfect. No. So we need to stop blaming other people. Doesn't help us, just creates more of our karmic burden. When we blame somebody else, we're blaming ourselves. Everybody's doing the best they can. They really are. Life's hard. It's hard for everyone. It is. And you want to think about this. In order to love, you got to put yourself out there. You got to be honest. You got to be honest with yourself. You got to be honest with somebody else. You have to be vulnerable. That's hard. Put yourself out there to get hurt. But if you've got your act together, if you know who you are, if you love yourself, you can afford a little hurt, okay? You learn to ride a bicycle. You learn to play soccer. You learn to play football. You got hurt. But there was value in that. So when you're together as a person, then we can allow ourselves to be vulnerable and honest and not manipulate. What games do you play? God, I played them for years. I mean, we all played them. Hard to get. Anticipating what the other person would think or feel. Worrying about what somebody else felt. Not being open because you didn't want to be judged. That's all. Okay. You're playing games with the person you love in your life? What a waste of time. Our egocentric person becomes our mirror. if we have the courage to look at it. Are we not, both of us in the relationship, are we not both egocentric at some time, in some sense? Think about it. Now, what is more selfish or egotistical or arrogant? What is more arrogant than to say, here, I'm going to fix you? I'm going to fix you. I'm fixed myself, but I can fix you. Well, you know, if you're a professional, you get paid for it. But you're not doing that with attachment. But it is your ego. Those of us that are givers in these situations, and most of the time we're trying to make you into a better person. That's pretty arrogant. Probably don't want to hear that. I didn't want to figure it out. Believe I didn't. That one took me a couple weeks to get over. When we're dealing with this egocentric person, what they're forcing us to do is because we keep giving and really not getting anything back, except maybe feel a little superior, we become depleted. And at that point, when they suck us dry, that's when we have to start taking care of ourselves. And that's when we start establishing boundaries. We should learn that we're in a control fight here. We're right fighters. They're trying to control us. We're trying to control them. Most of the time, we don't want to admit we are because we want them to change, which maybe they do need to change, but that's between them and God. What do you think of it? We think we're a better person because we're given. We think we're a better person because we're going to fix them. We suffer them. But what are we doing? We're in self-sacrifice. We're in martyrdom. This is hard to, I know it's hard to hear this. And I tell you, if you can really get into this, then we get filled with self-pity. And when we're filled with this, and I spend all my time trying to fix you, I don't have the time or the energy to work on my own issues. And I can blame you for all my pain. Okay? I don't blame myself because I didn't make choices, because I didn't set boundaries. I'm saying you're doing this to me. Are they? We have choices. I understand why we do this. I've done it myself. I'm not saying, had a marriage that I did that way. But I realized what I did. And when we were dealing in these situations, our inner dragons come out. One of my mentors and teachers, Robert Ahata, the intuitive astrologer, I love Robert. He talks about our inner dragons. That's our perfectionist, our critic, our judge, our wounded child. All of these parts of us, our personality, our aspects, are triggered by these relationships, these mirrors that they create for us. And we can't keep, if we stay in a relationship, we have to do something about them. Do something about them. And these are the parts of us that have to be healed, to heal. And our egoist, our narcissist type person, they trigger every fear and self-doubt you have in yourself. And so you have to evaluate, if you're going to stay in the situation, if you're going to survive, you're going to have to look at that and maybe do something about it. We're forced to heal ourselves. And we're not going to make changes until the pain of now becomes worse than our fear of the future and what it's going to be. And losing the love that we think is there. It's a little difficult. And we can go through the dark night of the soul in these relationships. if you got the courage to stay in there for a little while. This is definitely not the world most travel. Most people are not going to look at themselves. They don't do the autopsy on the relationship. They condemn the relationship. They say all the things the other guy's got wrong, but they don't do the autopsy on themselves and see, you know, what was my stuff in here? What was I supposed to want? You know, what was my shit that I didn't take care of? And there's going to be both sides. No, I'm not. You know, the other guy has, the egoist has all kinds of problems and issues that need to be dealt with. But we're talking about us as the giver and the narcissist is in our lives. So I'm being, you know, looking at it from their perspective. If you're dealing with a twin flame or a soulmate in the relationship, you aren't going to get out of it, okay? Because these are really strong contracts that you made. So you might as well deal with it. Because if you don't deal with it this lifetime, you're going to have to do another lifetime. And there's no place to run to. Do it now. Do it next lifetime. Personally, I don't want to. I don't want to keep coming back to doing this show. I want to learn as much as I can in this lifetime. Whether this is a karmic relationship and you have ties with them and you can identify past lives, you're still working in this third dimension. And that's where they have to be solved. I do regression work. I mean, it's part of what people pay me for. And certainly it'll give you clarity. And then you can begin to see the patterns. And then you can see the pattern in this lifetime. And that can speed things up. But you still have to learn the lessons and make the choices in this lifetime. It just makes it faster. Makes it faster. I found that it definitely has for me. And even if you've got what we call a fifth dimension level relationship with somebody where you have telepathy with them, and you recognize those past lives and you clear some of them from your side, it still has to be worked out in this dimension. You still have to learn the love and the forgiveness. Forgiveness is simply letting go. Just let go of it, which is extremely hard to do. Easier said than done. I think that's one of the biggest things that in life, that the hardest lessons for most of us to learn is to let go. But again, we have to learn to unconditionally love. So even though this person in your life is causing you a lot of pain, if you look at what are you learning from it, and if you look at the stuff that about them that really irritates you, you just might find that there's an aspect of that inside of you. It may be clothed differently. You may do it a little differently. But you see the people that really tick us off, we do a little of that too. It's a reflection. And we don't want to see it in ourselves. We don't want to see it. We will justify our behavior in a different way. Bullying is one of them. That's a hard one. Most of us don't realize how easy it is for us to be bullies. So when you see that, you have to ask yourself, you know, what am I doing? So don't shoot the messenger. Okay. Actually, this person in your life, or however long that they're there, maybe they could turn out to be your best friend, because they gave you the opportunity to grow if you're willing to take it and run with it. And you come out the other side of this relationship a better person, learn how to love. And when you got your act together and you know who you are and you don't judge people so much anymore, and you don't judge yourself, then you have the tools and the capacity to really have a loving relationship with another human being. So maybe they did you a service. Something to think about. Think about it. Ask me questions. Go to my website. You can do that. Send me a letter. I'm there. Okay, now how do I turn this thing off? I always forget how to turn this thing off. Okay, where is it? Okay, I'll see you for the next one. We can put a whole series of these in here. Nice talking to you.